I'll be talking about the current evidence in the ovarian reserve, in particular relation to the polycystic ovarian syndrome. Basically, I'll be covering the ovarian reserves, different ovarian reserve markers. Are there any cutoff points for PCOS, let's say the AMH or the AFC, the accuracy of these tests, and the decline in the ovarian reserve with age, and what could be done about it. We all know that women are born with around 20 million oocytes, and as we grow, the number of oocytes go on reducing to about 4 lakhs when we attain puberty, and by the time the woman is around 37 years, it's around 25,000. The functional potential of the ovary is reflected by the number and the quality of oocytes within. The ovarian age per se talks about the quantity of the oocytes, while the chronological age talks about the quality of the oocytes. Let's understand what ovarian reserve is. It basically determines the capacity of the ovary to provide oocytes that are capable of fertilization, resulting in a healthy and successful pregnancy. It's basically a complex clinical phenomenon influenced by various factors like the age of the woman, genetics, and the other environmental factors by which the lady is exposed to. The decline is irreversible, but the rate varies from woman to woman. Ovarian reserve markers. The ovarian reserve markers serve as a proxy for the oocyte quantity, but they are considered as a poor predictor for the quality of the oocytes. What could be the indications for these ovarian reserve tests? Well, women who have come to us for infertility treatment, we are planning an IVF treatment, for individualization of protocols, in history where there is a history of premature ovarian failure in the family, also in polycystic ovarian syndromes, and women considering social egg freezing, or sometimes even when the lady has a malignancy and she is going to be treated with some gonadotoxic therapy. So basically, it helps us in having an informed decision about the childbearing, planning rapidity and mode of treatment, and assess our response and probability of pregnancy, also to limit the attempts and exclude in the poor responders. We have various markers of ovarian reserve, most important of which is age. We all know that beyond the age of 35, 36 years, it's one of the basic markers which shows about the oocyte quality. The other markers are the basal hormonal levels, amongst which are important are the FSH and the anti-Müllerian hormones. We also have various sonographic markers like the enteral follicular count, the ovarian volume and vascularity. And there are some challenging tests or dynamic tests which are not used generally because they are quite cumbersome, like the clomiphene citrate challenge test or the GnRH agonist stimulation test. What would be an ideal ovarian reserve test? Well, the one which could predict conception with or without treatment, predict the line of onset of ovarian aging, help us in selection of an optimal dose of gonadotropins for stimulation. It should be easily measurable, minimally invasive, inexpensive, and should have a good predictive value. It should also minimize the risk of wrongly diagnosing somebody with a diminished or poor ovarian reserve and accurately identify those who are at greater risk for developing hyperstimulation. Well, such a marker test does not really exist, but then let's have a brief look towards the various markers which are available. Like I said, age is the most important marker and it still remains the best predictor of the oocyte quality. However, the chronological age alone has limited value in predicting the individual ovarian response. We all know that as the age increases, there is a reduction in the follicular number and also probably the oocyte quality. Whether they are both synchronous or not, that we do not know. This causes increase in the risk of embryonic chromosomal abnormalities and spontaneous abortions. This is a good study in human reproduction in 2006, which talks about the decline in the fertility with age, which is both qualitative and quantitative. Thus, female age is one of the most important predictors in IVF treatment and only predictor to predict the probability of having a pregnancy, that is live birth. Coming to the other markers, that is the basal FSH, enteral follicular count, and AMH. Amongst the three, the AMH is the only test which can be done irrespective of the menstrual cycle. The FSH and the enteral follicular count need to be done during the menstrual phase, day 2 to day 5. Also, there is lots of intra-cycle variability when we talk about the basal FSH and the enteral follicular count, which is not seen with the AMH levels. The inter-cycle variability, that is between the two menstrual cycles, is also seen with the basal FSH, although not that much with the enteral follicular count. To summarize in short, it appears like AMH is one of the better tests.
What are the advantages of doing FSH? Well, it is commonly available, widespread. It was one of the initial tests which was used. However, it does have certain limitations. Its reliability is lesser, it has got lower sensitivity, and it is because it's dependent upon the functional hypothalamo-pituitary axis, hence less precision because of the intercycle and intracycle variability. Also, it does not predict the ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome, which is one of the most dreaded complications in ovulation induction. Coming to the antral follicular count, it does give us an immediate results with very good predictive value, especially for the stimulation of ovarian response, including the prediction of ovarian hyperstimulation. However, there is significant inter-observer variability, which depends upon the machine as well as the person. And sometimes there is also intercycle variation, especially when we have an obese individual or an overweight person. Coming to the anti-Müllerian hormone, it's very reliable, highly sensitive, and has got a good predictive value for stimulation of the ovarian response, including prediction of the ovarian hyperstimulation. The drawbacks or the limitations could be lack of standardization. Still, we are struggling with it, and it also requires careful sample preparation as well as storage. Various cutoff values have been suggested in literature. For example, the basal FSH being more than 10 or 20, the antral follicular counts being less than 3 or 4, and the AMH, they are saying between 0.1 to 1.5. The sensitivity and specificity of the AMH and the AFC is better as compared to the FSH. When you look at the expression of the ovarian reserve markers, as you can be seen that the AMH is secreted by the recruited follicles. Hence, it gives us a better indicator of the ovarian reserve as opposed to the other markers which are not used commonly now, that is inhibins and the estradiol levels. So, which ovarian test to choose? Well, of course, the AMH and AFC are currently showing an upper hand as compared to the FSH because the AMH is directly produced by both the cumulus and the mural granulosa cells from the pre-antral and the small antral follicles during early folliculogenesis. The AMH declines years prior to the reduction or to the rise in FSH levels. Hence, it is a more sensitive and a real-time biomarker as opposed to the FSH, which is an indirect marker. So, considering the ovarian reserve test, the NICE guidelines, which were updated in 2017, says that we should not use the ovarian volume, ovarian blood flow, inhibin B and estradiol levels for measuring the ovarian reserve. We could have something like the antenatal growth charts for the ovarian reserve curves. This can help us identify patients who will have poor prognosis or may sometimes have higher response to the ovulation induction. It will also help in individualization of the treatment protocols for having optimal results and minimizing the safety risk. It will also help us to educate the people and counsel them regarding their menopausal timing and aid in treatment strategies, especially in young female patients having cancers. Coming to what tests are best for PCOS patients? Well, AMH and AFC seems to be the better ones amongst the armamentarium which we have currently. AMH correlates well with the antral follicular count between 2 to 5 millimeters and also has been proposed as one of the biochemical markers of PCOS. We all are well aware about the Rotterdam criteria, which includes oligo or anovulation, hyperandrogenism and polycystic morphology of the ovaries on ultrasonography. But with the recent advances and newer machines, the number of the follicular number per ovary, the criteria itself is changing. The latest international PCOS guidelines in 2018 has now increased the FNPO to more than 20 to be labeled as PCO, and the ovarian volume is around 10 cubic millimeter. Asian women do have a lower FNPO. We can say that AMH is a surrogate marker for PCOM instead of the antral follicular count, especially in the elderly group where the women are more than 30 years of age. Let's understand what regulates the entry of the follicles into the growing pool and why AMH is important. AMH basically inhibits the initial recruitment of the follicles, thereby the primordial follicular pool does not enter into the follicular growth of the follicles. This is also inhibited. They act by acting on the FSH and the cytochrome P19 enzymes, and hence the recruitment is avoided. AMH basically regulates the growth, initiation as well as the threshold for the FSH sensitivity. Looking at the non-PCOS ovary and the PCOS ovary, FSH acts on the AMH levels, but it also acts on the E2 levels. When the E2 levels rise because of the positive feedback, the ERB receptors block the AMH levels and hence the follicle recruitment begin. In PCOS women, the AMH levels are very high and the E2 levels do not increase to that level, which inhibits and causes follicular arrest. Could there be certain cutoff values for the AMH to diagnose PCOS? Well, there have been various studies. This is one of the very recent studies in June 2019 published, which shows that the Caucasian population have got a higher AMH values as compared to the Indian population. And in Indian population, the AMH levels in women with PCOS phenotype A was significantly higher than the other phenotypes. And these are these women who are at high risk for developing OHSs. When we looked at the Indian population, possibly a value of around 5 nanograms per ml could be taken as the cutoff, while the other Asian groups showed a much higher value. How are the AMH levels different in these PCOS women? Well, the AMH production on an average was around 75 times higher in the granulosa cells from the anovulatory PCOS and 20 times in the ovulatory PCOS when we compare them to the healthy ovaries. This increased AMH is the intrinsic property of the granulosa cells and it persists even after when we stimulate them with IVF protocols. The increased AMH concentration is also seen in the follicular fluid. And thus, the anovulatory PCOS have 18 times higher AMH values. Various studies have been showing that. Some of the important facts, well, the cutoff value of AMH have been proposed. And like I said, there are different studies are showing different values. But when we looked at the AMH values predicting amenorrhea, any AMH value more than 11 was significantly showing a high sensitivity and specificity in predictive amenorrhea. Higher AMH in PCOS women was associated with insulin resistance also. There was a causative correlation between AMH, HOMA insulin resistance as well as the insulin levels, while a negative correlation between the AMH and HOMA B. Relationship between the AMH and insulin resistance was found to be independent of the PCO morphology. What is the importance of AMH and AFC in PCOS? Well, the lower rate of AMH fall increases their fertility window in these PCOS women. The increase in the number of recruitable follicles, even at an advanced stage, allows for better ART outcomes. But one thing needs to be understood that even though we have large number of follicles, probably they have a poor oocyte quality. Why does this happen? Because of heterogeneity of steroidogenesis between the individual follicles, altered intra-follicular environment, increase in the granulosa cell apoptosis, impaired mitochondrial function either due to oxidative stress or epigenetic modulation. When we correlate between the AMH and AFC, it shows a positive correlation as expected. AMH is tightly correlated with the smaller antral follicles between 2 to 5 millimeters and it has been shown to be increased in association with the LH levels. To conclude, in Indian population, ABN AMH levels of more than 5 nanograms per ml could be one of the indicators of PCOS. It will help in differentiating between the different phenotypes of PCOS and could likely emerge as an important marker of PCOS and probably replace the PCOS morphology, which is now used in the diagnostic criteria for women in the reproductive age group. What are the recommendations? These are by the International Evidence Guidelines for Assessment and Management of PCOS published in 2018. They said that currently AMH should not be used as an alternative for detection of PCOS. With improved standardization of assays and established cutoff levels, probably AMH may become more accurate in the detection of PCOS morphology. And because of the ethnic variability, Indian women probably have higher infertility and lower live birth rates. Let's understand a little bit about the genetics of PCOS. PCOS women do have a genetic predisposition to excess of androgen and various other metabolic syndromes. Various studies have shown that they have a gene linked to the steroid hormone production, the metabolic parameters, androgen action, as well as the follicle development. There are various studies which have documented that there are chromosomal abnormalities, some genes associated with them, and alteration in these expression can occur in either of the organs or tissues like the anterior pituitary, which could influence the hormonal regulation of the ovary as well as the adipose tissue. Let's come back to the AMH and AFC and how does it help in PCOS? Well, high AFC and a serum AMH is a surrogate marker for oligoanovulation and hyperandrogenism. AMH could be used to establish treatment protocols, particularly in defining strategy for ovulation induction in infertile women with oligo or anovulation. And AMH and AFC is the value in predicting OHSs also. This is one of the studies in 2008 where it showed that The optimal cutoff they had pointed out was around 3.36, with a very good sensitivity of around 90% and specificity of 81% in predicting the hyper response to ovulation induction in IVF cycles. Again, if we are thinking of predicting, looking at the antral follicular count, this was another study which said that when the antral follicular count was more than 14, it had got a very good sensitivity in predicting hyper response, that is more than 20 oocytes were recovered. So sensitivity and specificity for production of high ovarian response was very good when you have the antral follicular count of more than around 14 to 16 and an AMH of around 4.86. Ovulation and pregnancy rates were significantly higher when you are using clomiphene citrate, to rate of 97% ovulation and 46% patients conceived when they had low AMH, that is less than 3.4. So AMH more than 3.4 was associated with a poorer prognosis. AMH itself per se is a weaker predictor of live birth rates in patients undergoing IVF. When we looked at the day 3 AMH, which was more than 3.2, it was a predictor of higher insulin resistance. Like I said earlier, it has got a positive correlation with the insulin resistance. And women undergoing laparoscopic ovarian drilling, it was found that all those women who had very high AMH to the tune of 7.7 ovulated when they underwent laparoscopic ovarian drilling. As per the NICE guidelines, which were again updated in April 2018, low responders are the one where the AFA, the antral follicular count is less than or equal to 4, and hyper responders are the one where you have the antral follicular count of more than 16. AMH less than or equal to 5.4 picomoles showed a lower response, while more than 25 showed hyper response. The FSH they have quoted as more than 8.9 and less than 4. Poor event reserve has been described by various factors, by various categories, but recently the Poseidon group labeled the patient as those who have low prognosis group instead of the poor ovarian reserve, because even in this low prognosis group you can have two subgroups. Some women have good ovarian reserve, they are young but they are poor responders, while the other, they are older with a good ovarian reserve but they respond poorly. The other arm is the poor ovarian reserve. These are the older poor responders, or sometimes even the younger poor responders. PCOS is one of those. Despite having increased antral follicular count, they can be poor responders. Basically, this criteria demonstrated the ability to retrieve the number of oocytes necessary to obtain at least one euploid embryo for transfer in each patient. It was based on the FOAT criteria, FOAT or the follicular output rate, which was basically the ratio of the pre-ovulatory follicles, that is the follicle size between 16 to 20 millimeters in diameter count on the day of your HCG trigger, upon divided by the small antral follicles, which were around 3 to 8 millimeters in diameters at the baseline. It gave an indication about the ovarian sensitivity to the gonadotropins, which was different from one patient to the another. It helped in evaluating this, which was one of the major factors in the response of these patients. Thus, FOAT is an efficient quantitative qualitative marker of ovarian response to gonadotropins and could help in decision of treatment protocols, gonadotropin stimulation doses for these hyporesponder patients. This is an interesting study which showed that the number of retrieved oocytes was highest when we have high FOAT value. However, the fertilization rate and the good quality oocytes was significantly higher in the medium FOAT group, and also the pregnancy outcome achieved was better in the PCOS group in the medium FOAT group. Looking at the PCOS, what is the difference? Do the PCOS women age differently as compared to the other women? Well, this was an interesting study in human reproduction which correlated the ovarian volume, the number of antral follicular counts, AMH, PCOS status, and the age in the pre- and the postmenopausal PCOS women. What they found was that the ovarian reserve declined at a similar rate in both the groups, as you can see in these charts. However, the PCOS women always had a better ovarian reserve across the ages as compared with the controls. To summarize, I would say that young women with PCOS do have an increased ovarian reserve compared to their age-matched controls. Polycystic ovaries are large, they contain more number of antral follicles as assessed by the ultrasonography, and higher levels of AMH in these women as compared to the control group. AMH is crucial in maintaining the right tempo of folliculogenesis in ovaries, making it one of the most important ovarian hormones and crucial factors underpinning the female infertility. AMH currently is the best biochemical marker of ovarian function. It's easier to measure and also measures the submerged part of the iceberg of follicular growth, also called as the acyclic ovarian activity. High elevated AMH levels predict a poor response to the various treatment strategies of PCOS like weight reduction, ovulation induction, or laparoscopic ovarian drilling. However, they are still not very predictive of the live birth rates. Thank you very much.
Good evening, everybody.